Good morning and thank you. So today we'll be looking at cerebral venous thrombosis and the pathophysiology and how we can manage this condition better understanding the pathophysiology. And also I think the PGs and the juniors should be aware of all the studies which we had published from our department and the ongoing trials and the high and great potential for further studies and research in this field, for which everybody is welcome, including the Department of Medicine. So when we talk about cerebral venous thrombosis, it can be either the thrombosis of the dural venous sinuses and or the cortical veins on the surface of the brain. So if you look at the literature, it's rather uncommon cause for strokes in the West. But in some countries, it is more common, like in Mexican stroke registry, it constitutes almost 3% of all strokes. And our data from CMC, which is similar to that of NIMHANS and other parts of South India especially, it constitutes almost 7% of all acute strokes seen in the emergency services. Now, if you look at the age group, you see that as you grow older, the incidence is much less. Above 80, you hardly see any patients presenting with this condition. So this is more than around 80% of this CVTs occur mainly in young age, that is less than 50 years of age. The important thing is CVT is the main cause, constituting 50% of all pregnancy and puerperium related strokes, especially in Asian countries. Looking at the etiology, you can have anything which can cause CVT, ranging from high altitude to high voltage brain injury. So you can see anything in literature causing this. This is one of the studies which we published recently, looking at the ambient temperature and climatic conditions. So this study we did in and around Vellore, covering almost five districts, and over an 8-year period, we had almost more than 1,000 patients with CVT. And here you can see that there was a definite relationship with high ambient temperature and the incidence of CVT. So if you look at the hot summer months of April, May, June, the incidence was significantly higher than in other months. If you look at the winter months, it's much less. So this, I'm sure the registrars will be seeing this every day happening in the ward during the summer months. Now, if you look at the etiology, you can divide it into transient and permanent risk factors. So there are a host of these risk factors. But if you look at the cause and effect relationship, the things which stands out, one is mainly the oral contraceptive and hormonal use. And this is a very, very important and preventable risk. And there are other permanent risk factors which you can detect only if you check the blood, that is protein C, protein S deficiency, and the genetic mutations like factor V laden, prothrombin gene, and antiphospholipid syndrome, and also hyperhomocysteinemia. Now, if you look at the odds ratio for this, you see that some of them are having a very high odds, like protein S and C, you have an odds of more than 10. Hyperhomocysteinemia is not much now, but the important thing is the combination of risk factors, which is important in causing this condition. For example, if you have a lady who has a prothrombin mutation, the odds is 9.3. If this lady starts taking oral contraceptives, which by itself it has an odds of 5.6, but if this lady, if there's a combination of this risk factor, the odds just multiplies. It doesn't add, but multiplies and becomes almost 150. Similarly, if you have a pregnant lady who has a very high homocysteine level, again, the odds multiplies. So the genetic and the protein deficiencies are very, very important. And so much so in some countries now, before prescribing oral contraceptives, they started checking for these mutations before for safety in prescribing. This is one of the studies which are done long time back from our department, which looked at the underlying prothrombotic states in pregnancy-related CVT. And one thing we found was in this area, in and around, especially in many districts of South India, there is a traditional practice that after delivery, you don't give water to the mother. You restrict the water intake. Most of the time, what we saw was they'll be given one cup of water and then they are told to take it throughout the day. No extra. This is like for the thought is that it'll concentrate the breast milk or it'll reduce the stomach, which is post-delivery, etc. So this was found to be significantly affected, significantly associated with the incidence of CVT in postpartum CVT. And also we found that up to 71% of the postpartum CVT patients had multiple risk factors, prothrombotic risk factors. Now coming to the pathophysiology, it's very, very important to understand the pathophysiology to understand how we can treat this condition. The first thing you should know is there are some features which are unique to the intracranial venous circulation. That is the veins, it's the veins which contains around 70% of the blood inside the brain. And these sinuses don't have muscular tissue in their thin walls. There are no walls up to the jugular veins. And hence the dural sinuses won't collapse like arteries. And there is high variability in their anatomy. This is very important. And so literature has shown that the transverse sinus can be predominantly right-sided in up to 40% of the subjects. So, and this is one study which was done from our radiology department, which also showed similar figures, left transverse sinus hypoplastic in 35%. So this is very important because if you're suspecting CVT and you're seeing a scan and you see a hypoplastic sinus, you should be double checking whether it is really a thrombosis or just a normal finding. Now, looking at the pathophysiology, you just look at this cartoon. You have the dural sinus here. You have the artery which is taking the blood into the brain, which finally forms arterioles and then capillaries. And then you have the venules which start draining the venous blood into veins. And then finally you have the cortical veins which empties into the large dural sinuses. And the blood finally gets out through the jugular veins. It's not visible properly. So we'll see what happens when you have a thrombosis of one of these major dural sinuses. The first thing will happen is the veins cannot drain properly into these sinuses and there'll be venous congestion. Okay. So what we should remember is if you look at the Monroe-Kelly hypothesis, you know that the volume inside the brain is fixed, contributed by CSF, brain and blood. And as we saw earlier, it's a venous blood which constitutes 70% of this volume of the blood. So because of this venous congestion, immediately you can have increase in ICP and you can have an increase in the post-capillary venous pressure here. Okay. Now what the brain can do to counter this, it will try to reduce the CSF. So that is one the first buffer which the brain can act on. So how it does is it will try to increase the absorption of CSF, try to drain out the CSF. And so this is the first compensatory mechanism by increasing the CSF absorption. So where does the CSF get absorbed? It's in the arachnoid granulation, which is situated mainly in the transverse sinuses and the superior sagittal sinuses. So you can hear this is the picture of the arachnoid granulations, which protruding into these sinuses. But however, we have a condition here where these very sinuses, which is supposed to drain out the CSF itself, is occluded. Okay. So the CSF buffer immediately is inactive. So what is happening here is you have a dual pathology now. One, the ICP is going up and the first compensatory mechanism, which is increased drainage of the CSF, is not working. And this will add on to your intracranial pressure and increase the edema. So this can lead on to venous infarct and vasogenic edema. And if it increases, you can potentially have a leak in the capillaries, the venules, and you can get venous hemorrhage. Okay. So this is up to this, this condition can be reversed if treated early. If this continues and the venous edema is untreated, what will happen is this pressure here will start reflecting on the capillaries. The capillaries is not able to push out the blood, and the perfusion here will fail because of the increased capillary pressure. You start getting cytotoxic edema. Okay. And rarely you will even see this can also be reversed if treated early. And there is also the talk of penumbra, like window in even in CVT. But whatever it is, this is a very short window, and we usually end up with large venous infarct with edema and hemorrhage and mass effect like this scan you can see here. And potentially this patient can go into herniation and worsen. So now if you look at this cascade, it's not same in all patients. Okay, some patients it can move fast, some patients can move slowly. And depending on the progress of this cascade, the presentation will vary. So most of the patients we see presents in a subacute presentation, that is more than 48 hours up to 30 days. And a big number also can present less than 48 hours. Okay. So we don't know why this happened. Some of them may be having a hypoplastic sinus on one side. Those patients may be the one who's presenting early, etc. And the symptoms they present with, mainly it's related to the raised intracranial pressure, that is headache, vomiting, papilledema, visual obscurations. And if the ICP is really elevated, they can have stupor, coma, especially if the deep venous system is involved. And if there is associated venous infarction, especially if the cortical venous infarction, they can have focal deficits, which can even mimic a stroke and seizures. And also don't forget, the patients can have symptoms and signs related to the underlying condition itself, which has caused CVT. So always look for any ear signs, ear infection, meningeal signs for infection, etc. So as you saw, the diagnosis is mainly by demonstration of thrombus in a dural sinus or the cortical veins, as you can see here. So you can see here, there is a small, on the superior sagittal sinus, there is a thrombus with lot of edema and infarct. So there are some signs. On a plain scan, you can see this dense transverse sinus sign, which if you look carefully, and you can see this cord sign, or if there is a cortical vein which is thrombosed on a plain scan. And similarly, on a contrast scan, you can see this empty delta sign, where you have the contrast which is filling around the thrombus and causing an empty delta sign. And you can see the thrombus on T2 and flare as a flow void, as you can see here. And on contrast, you can see the similar signs, what you see on a contrast CT, you can see the contrast filling around the thrombus in this patient with the straight sinus thrombosis and thalamic infarct. So now coming to the treatment, as you saw, the pathophysiology is, there are a lot of things acting at the same time. So your treatment also, you should be targeting multiple areas at the same time. The first and foremost is to increase your venous return by unblocking the blocked dural sinuses and the veins. You can reduce your CSF by whatever methods possible. Treatment of vasogenic and cytotoxic edema should go side by side. And rarely you might require surgical decompression in these patients. And also make sure you treat the underlying cause for CVT. Otherwise, you can have early recurrence and the patient may not improve in the early setting itself. And there are some special situations which might warrant special treatment. We'll come to it later. So first and foremost is facilitating venous return. And the mainstay for this is using systemic anticoagulation. rarely you might do a thrombectomy or plus minus thrombolysis in this acute setting. But first and foremost, simple things which can make a big difference. First is head positioning. So you want the whatever venous return is coming out of the cranium, you should facilitate it by avoiding any flexion of the neck or rotation. And the common thing you should know is not to place any tight fitting mask with the tight elastic around the neck, which will occlude the jugular. If the patient is receiving ventilator, when you make sure there is, you avoid a high PEEP, which also can impede the venous and increase the ICP, and also avoid frequent suctioning where your ICP can intermittently go up. The patient may be sitting on the fence and that itself can tilt the patient and cause herniation. And avoid jugular catheter. This is very, very important. As we saw, some of them can have a dominant side flow. So you always look at the, in case you have to place a IJV, you make sure you look at the scan and see which is the dominant side. So never place it on the, try to avoid it, if at all, place on the non-dominant side. And also avoid abdominal compression. Okay. So these are small things which will make a big difference. Systemic anticoagulation, as I told you, has been proven to be effective with a 60% relative risk of death or dependency. Now we have choice between unfractionated and low molecular weight heparin. And but studies have shown that low molecular weight heparin is much better in terms of outcome in treating CVT in the acute phase. But there are some conditions where we need to use unfractionated heparin. One is renal insufficiency. And second thing is, if you know this patient might go in for surgery, for early reversal, make sure you use only unfractionated heparin. So there are some conditions where one might hesitate and think twice of starting heparin. One is hemorrhagic transformation of the venous infarct, which is very common, seen in almost 50% of our patients. Here, there is no doubt you have to use anticoagulation. And up to 6% can present with associated subarachnoid hemorrhage. Okay, here also don't hesitate, you have to start anticoagulation. And thirdly, you can sometimes have patients presenting with subdural associated with CVT, called non-traumatic subdural hematoma. And here, if the hematoma is huge, then you might need surgical evacuation because of mass effect. But small ones, definitely you can go ahead and give anticoagulation. So CVT is one condition where, in spite of you having intracranial bleed, you still can treat, you have to treat with heparin and other anticoagulation. Now coming to anticoagulation, one word of caution, especially with this pandemic, we have to be aware of one condition called vaccine-associated CVT. Okay, so this is usually seen 5 to 30 days post-vaccine and commonly reported with the Covishield vaccine. So here what happens is, the post-vaccines, the patient can develop antibodies against platelet factor 4. And this will induce a heparin-induced thrombocytopenia-like picture. So the importance of early detection of this condition is, if you give these people heparin, the condition can worsen, and even deaths have been reported in this COVID vaccine-associated CVT by using heparin. So how you treat this is by giving direct oral anticoagulants. Okay, you can either use factor 10A inhibitors like apixaban or rivaroxaban, or even direct thrombin inhibitors. Plus, you have to use high-dose immunoglobulin, which will prevent more platelet getting activated by blocking the antibody. And in refractory cases, you need to do plasma exchange and immunosuppression. Recently, we had a discussion on this. So the expert, what they're saying is, in the ICU, no, everywhere you see, you have heparin. You use heparin locks, you use... See, some of these patients are in Germany, that almost 150 patients. So even a small dose of heparin may be harmful. So even heparin locks, they're advising we should be careful in, if you suspect this. So make sure you look out for this condition. In India, This is only one case which has been reported, still getting published. I think Bobby has reported from Cochin. And so any patient with CVT, you look for thrombocytopenia. History of vaccination should be asked for all patients. And the patient might have very high D-dimer level. Usually patients with CVT can have a elevated D-dimer, but this patient, the D-dimer will be very high. And the patient might be worsening in front of your eyes on heparin without any other reason. So this you should suspect and then look for this anti-platelet factor 4 antibody, which our hematology is doing. Okay, you can contact Dr. Sharji in hematology. Okay, what about thrombolytic agents in CVT? So like in stroke, can you use urokinase, streptokinase or TPA? So people have used it, and only thing is there has been high incidence of hemorrhagic complication in the around 10%. So one reason for this is the high thrombus load in CVT when compared to your arterial stroke. So next step is whether we can deliver these thrombolytic agents intra-sinus. So it will affect locally, it will act locally and less of systemic complication. And there has been a lot of studies on this balloon assisted thrombectomy and thrombolysis, where you can go in with a balloon, you macerate the thrombus, inflate the balloon, and then give the agent locally. So the whatever you are giving won't come back because you have an inflated balloon here. So it, more time you are giving for it to act locally. And also mechanical thrombectomy devices, which we usually use in ischemic stroke, has been used extensively. And there has been, we also published one series on this using the Penumbra system for CVT with very good results. But all of these are retrospective case series. The only prospective study which looked at endovascular treatment, compared endovascular treatment versus medical treatment in CVT, was the 2-ACT trial, where they randomized patients with high risk of clinical deterioration into medical and endovascular arm. But however, this study failed to show benefit of endovascular treatment. But there are a lot of criticism on this study. One, first of all, it was underpowered with only 67 patients. And the endovascular treatment strategy they used was heterogeneous. Like some of them received mechanical only, some of them received both mechanical and chemical lysis. So the last word on this is not yet out. Whatever it is, there are a lot of unanswered questions in this. One is the time window, when you should intervene. Second thing is the morphology of the thrombus, whether it's a thrombus has formed maybe 2 weeks back and now you are trying to clean it up, or formed recently. And also a lot of publication bias by underreporting of poor outcome cases. So we should definitely consider endovascular treatment if patient versus worsening on medical treatment. If there are any contraindication for systemic anticoagulants, or especially with thrombosis of the deep venous sinuses, and when the vision is threatened with a benign intracranial hypertension like presentation of CVT, which we'll come to shortly. So the next step is to improve reduce your CSF by using any drugs possible, like acetazolamide is what we commonly use, which will decrease the CSF production. Topiramate or furosemide can also be tried. If you look at the European guidelines, they don't recommend acetazolamide, but we still use, and I think we should continue to use unless, and we are not seen any adverse outcome. Sometimes we might have to use lumbar puncture to remove CSF if there is no contraindication till we recanalize the sinuses. Treatment of vasogenic and cytotoxic edema, we can use 3% saline, which is standard. And if there is no breach in blood-brain barrier, we can use mannitol. Steroids was tried, but failed to demonstrate benefit. And also remember, steroids have potential thrombotic property. So it's better, you should not use steroid. No, not much literature on it. Prevention of seizures, this is one thing which is very, very important. So if you look at this patient here, he has a large vein of Labe thrombosis, and one seizure in this patient will suddenly increase the edema in that area and cause herniation. So this is like impending herniation with the seizure. So seizure is usually seen more commonly in younger age group, children, and more in children, and especially in those with parenchymal lesions, obviously. So any patient presenting with seizure, of course, we need to start, but also PMT and start this anticonvulsants in anybody with parenchymal supratentorial lesion, superior sagittal and cortical veins. You need to start even though there is no seizure. Any lesion anterior to the central sulcus and patients with focal deficit. So you should have a very low threshold for starting anticonvulsants. You can even start two anticonvulsants in the first few days, and then once the patient is stable, you come down. So surgical decompression. So as a life-saving measure, we do surgical decompression, especially like these patients with large hemorrhagic infarcts with edema and mass effect. So there has been a lot of literature looking at this, all case series, and one of the largest case series was published from our department. We had 44 patients which we had undergone decompression, and out of that we had a very good survival rate of 75, and the most important thing was 77% of the survivors achieved an MRS of 2 or less at 1 year, which is very, very impressive. Now, all of them are retrospective case series. The only prospective series is something called the Decompressive 2 study. This is a large multicentric international trial. The results of this trial will be presented next, 1st of September this year in the European Stroke Congress. So this is a very big trial, including we have been doing this study over the last 9 years, 15 centers in 10 countries. And in India, we had recruited 64 patients who had undergone decompression, and the result of the study is impressive. But it's not as good as what we thought it would be, 30% mortality. So anyway, we'll see the results published. Prognosis. So in the pre-MRI, MRV era, CVT was conditioned with high mortality and morbidity, okay, because the pickup was not very good. So it's almost 30 to 50% mortality. Now, once the MRI came up, the pickup became very fast and quick, and the treatment also changed. The mortality is now only in the range of 8 to 14%. But still, it is big number, and it is mainly affecting the young population. Okay, that's very, very important, and something which can be treated if picked up early. There is a prognostic scale for CVT, looking at the clinical picture, the radiological picture, and also some patients, if at all you do CSF, that also can be included. And any a score of more than 9 is very bad sign in these patients with high mortality. What about secondary prophylaxis? So following a CVT, you not only you have recurrence of CVT, but you can also have thrombosis in other vascular beds. Okay, so the annual risk of any type of thrombosis is almost 6.5%. And especially if the patient has an underlying severe thrombophilia. So you can either use usual coumarins, that is what you use, acitrom or warfarin, or the newer oral anticoagulants. So this was brought out in the RESPECT CVT study, which compared dabigatran 150 milligram twice daily with dose-adjusted warfarin. And this is the study which showed that you can use direct newer anticoagulants in treatment of CVT safely. There is one study which is ongoing, because this study, it is a study which looked at a lot of inclusion, exclusion criteria and all that. So this another study which has just started, which will be completed in 2024, is the DOAC CVT study, which is looking at the use of NOACs in the real world setting. So this study, what the study is doing is you can use whatever you want. You can use apixaban, rivaroxaban, dabigatran, and look how the patient is improving or recurrence, etc., over the usual anticoagulation. And we are also part of this international trial. Now, looking at how long to give your oral anticoagulants. Okay. So one thing is very clear is if you have a recurrence of CVT, if you have a recurrence of CVT, definitely lifelong. There's no second thoughts about it. If you have a severe thrombophilia, again, lifelong. But apart from that, it's not very clear. There are some centers, like, they don't even give anticoagulation. Once they discharge the patient is going home without any anticoagulant. Some centers treat for 6 months, some centers treat for 12 months. So there's no guidelines on this. So there's one study which is called the EXCOVA CVT study. So this is a cluster randomized trial, which is comparing the efficacy of short term, that is 3 to 6 months versus long term, that is 12 months, and seeing whether there is increase in the recurrence rate or versus complications of giving it over more than 6 months. So this is another study which we are also part of, and the results will be, because this is a long study, the results will be out only by maybe next end of next year. Now coming to some special situations where we need to go a little bit away from the usual management. This is like this one patient with a BIH like presentation. Okay, so this is a 30-year-old lady with headache, vomiting for 4 months, with transient visual obscurations, visual loss. Examination shows bilateral papilledema and optic atrophy. So you can see here, this is like a BIH like picture. You have flattening of the sclera, flattening of the pituitary. So what this patient has is chronic CVT with extensive collateral formation and no infarcts, absolutely no infarcts. So this is what we call as a BIH like presentation, only headache, and slowly they'll go into visual loss. So this is some series have reported up to 37 to 47% of this type of presentation in CVT. And the important thing is, if you have a patient with suspected IIH, if you investigate them for CVT, you will find 10% of them have actual CVT. So any patient with IIH, you need to rule out CVT before you establish the diagnosis. Okay. And the main thing is, CT can easily miss out the venous thrombosis in this patient. You need to suspect and get a contrast MRV. So treatment is to reduce your ICP. Then only you can save the vision. So you have two choices, optic nerve sheath fenestration, or like what you usually do in your BIH patient, you can do a thecoperitoneal shunt. Okay, so the important thing here is, what we have learned is, in these patients, doing a thecoperitoneal shunt is not very safe. The reason is, you have so much of collaterals form, and when you suddenly you do a TP shunt, there is something called bridging veins, which is all of them will be looking turgid and about to break. Easily you can break this, and the patient can get a hemorrhagic subdural hemorrhage. So it's important to know this and avoid doing TP shunt. The main thing is to go in for a optic nerve fenestration. There are other causes of visual loss in CVT, which we have published from our department. Other thing is venous infarcts, which can cause cortical occipital infarct and cause visual loss. Later on, the patient can have visual loss by secondary dural AV fistula. And also in acute setting itself, you might have a large venous infarct causing pressure on the PCAs and secondary arterial infarct with occipital infarct causing visual loss. The second condition which needs management is pregnancy. So if a pregnant lady who has a postpartum CVT again gets pregnant, there's no contraindication in continuing the pregnancy. You can treat with the low molecular weight heparin and tide over this. I think Atif, you were supposed to publish
this.
Okay, and the last one is deep venous system thrombosis. And here, you can easily miss out this because the patient can have only isolated mental alteration in sensory MET presentation. Okay, and here also CT can miss these deep venous infarcts. And second thing which can happen is this can cause secondary ballooning of the ventricles by causing obstructive hydrocephalus, which might need a EVD placement. And these are the patients which we had seen responds very well to intrasinus thrombolysis. Okay, so in short, you see CVT is a condition with good outcome if you treat them early, and always target multiple areas at the same time while treatment, not only one target. And definitely endovascular treatment should be considered in any patient who's deteriorating with on medical treatment, and surgery should be offered in any life-threatening condition CVT. And also make sure you watch out for vaccine-induced CVT in this pandemic. Okay, we'll take any